Thanks, everybody. Thanks. It's like nice to see such a great turnout on a Sunday. I think it's Sunday. And thanks for having me here. I was told to go quickly so we could catch on schedule. And as you'll notice, I talk very fast, so that won't be a problem. So I'm going to follow up on some of the things that Dr. Clancy said about treatment of liver metastases, but this is going to be from a minimally invasive approach. Why is this important? You know, 9 out of 10 patients with neuroendocrine tumors get liver metastases. It's the most common and often only site of disease progression, even when there's disease outside the liver. When it progresses, it usually progresses in the liver. And it's really the most common cause of death eventually in neuroendocrine patients, that they die from liver failure. So this is a complicated algorithm of how we treat liver metastases, and I'm going to break it down into sort of two simple categories. So if we look at the people in the first column on the left, patients who come in who have no symptoms, they don't have obviously progressive disease, which means we had a couple scans, the tumors aren't growing. Their liver function's normal, and they have a very low tumor burden, so less than 25% of the liver is involved by tumor. Those people you could actually just watch and don't have to do anything and just get follow-up scans. I usually do every 3 months for a year to get a sense of pace of disease. And, you know, I have many patients who just kind of show up with liver mets, and then I don't do anything for years, and they just cook along. You can consider a curative resection or ablation, as Dr. Clancy described. So if you present with anatomically localized disease, sometimes we'll just have surgery just take it out and kind of reset the clock. Then we have patients who come in who are symptomatic or have signs that their tumors are growing, they're progressive, but they still have normal liver function, they still have a very low burden of disease, so those patients all get started on SSA, so octreotide or lanreotide, and again, we go scan them every 3 months. And if their symptoms are controlled and the tumors are stable, which they often are, again, that's all you need to do, and you may be able to get away with that for many years. Then we have the other group of patients. They come in and they have a heavier tumor burden. Maybe it's afflicting their liver function, so they have abnormal liver function blood tests. And those patients need to be treated more aggressively because you want to preserve the remaining liver and not put them at risk for liver failure. So those kind of patients we're going to evaluate for resection or ablation or embolization. Similarly, if you look at the little arrows at the bottom there, you know, if you've been put on octreotide or lanreotide and you're still symptomatic or your tumor's still progressing, then we would also say, okay, now we need to do something to treat your liver. And that, again, would be some form of liver-directed therapy, and we would sit in our tumor board and discuss between amongst ourselves and the surgeons who was going to do what. And then we do have some patients who come in with extensive disease outside their liver, so it's not liver-dominant disease, in which case we would probably prioritize a systemic therapy to treat their whole body. All right, so why do we embolize patients? Why do we treat you through the artery to the liver? And that's based on the blood supply of the liver. So the liver actually has two blood supplies, and back in the 1950s, people figured out, there's a pointer somewhere. Was there a pointer? Oh, there's a little itty-bitty thing. Okay, so the normal liver gets 3/4 of its blood from the portal vein, which is this huge vein the size of a hot dog that drains all the blood from your digestive tract to your liver. So the normal liver is getting 3/4 of its blood from this vein and 1/4 from this little artery called the hepatic artery. Tumors, when they grow in your liver, get all their blood from the artery. So based on that, even back in the 1960s, surgeons would go and just ligate. They would just tie off the artery to the liver to take all the blood away from the tumor, and the liver, normal liver itself would survive because it's getting its blood from the portal vein. And in fact, that worked kind of, sort of, for a while, but not as well as actually embolizing them. So back in starting about the 1970s, people said, well, why don't we, instead of tying off the artery of the liver, let's put a catheter in there and inject some particles or junk or goo or something and cut off the blood flow of the tumors that way instead of doing surgery. One thing that's important is to understand the plumbing of the liver. So just as you heard in the last lecture about the lung having segments, the liver has segments. There's 8 of them. Each segment has its own artery and vein and bile duct. So for the surgeons, this is important because if they're going to resect you, they have to kind of follow the dotted lines here so they can take out the tumor, but everything they leave behind has its plumbing intact. Otherwise, you end up with leaks and all sorts of problems in the liver. Similarly, when I'm treating patients, you know, I need to know what segments your tumors are in and what segments your tumors are not in so I can catheterize those, you know, treat the part of the liver that has tumor and leave the part that doesn't have tumor alone. Patients often look at their CAT scan or MRI and say, well, you're treating that tumor. And the answer is no. This is a plumbing-based therapy. If I catheterize the right lobe of your liver, I treat every tumor in the right lobe of your liver. When I catheterize the artery in the left lobe of your liver, I treat every tumor in the left lobe of your liver. So it's all based on plumbing. Now, what are we doing when we're in there? I don't know if this movie will run. I know you guys are sleeping on the table. You think we're watching Game of Thrones reruns on the screens, but actually, this is what we're looking at. Can you guys in the back hit the arrow to run the movie? Otherwise, it looks kind of boring. There it goes. All right, so we've got, you know, we're working down here, doing stuff with our catheters and our chemoembolic goo. We're looking at the screen, watching the blood flow going to your tumor. So here's a catheter, and then we do these fancy spins around you and make CAT scans, and we do 3D reconstructions. This is super cool, right? This is what we're doing while you're sleeping. And get pictures so we can actually track out the blood supply of the tumors, steer our catheters, and try to really localize it to the areas of the liver where the tumors are and spare areas that don't have tumor. So this is what it kind of looks like in a still picture. Here's a baseline CAT scan. So this is the liver. Here you can see a tumor here on the left lobe of the liver. Now we've catheterized, so this is an arteriogram. We have a catheter in here in the celiac artery, the main artery that feeds your liver and spleen. And then here is the artery going up to the liver and coming around, and we see this tumor here. So we steer our catheter way, way, way out here, and now we're injecting our chemoembolic goo, which shows up as black on the x-ray, and we see it saturating the tumor here. And then here's the follow-up CAT scan. So this is before treatment, and now after treatment, you can see this tumor that was formerly dark is now completely white because it's saturated with our chemoembolic emulsion that has iodine in it, and we've left the rest of the liver alone. All right, so the most important question is, when do you want to do this? And there's some clear-cut reasons to do it. So patients who are symptomatic despite octreotide or lanreotide. So if you're having symptoms that aren't controlled and you have liver metastases, embolizing your liver metastases works really well to control symptoms. Also, if your tumor bulk is threatening your liver function, so if you have so much tumor in there, you're starting to lose liver reserve, we want to debulk that and beat it back so the liver doesn't fail. So basically, you know, anyone who has like more than 25% of their liver taken over by tumor would usually say you should really consider being embolized now before you get into trouble. Neoadjuvant resection, so just as you saw in Dr. Clancy's talk, you know, we had that patient with a giant pancreas tumor and they got chemotherapy and it shrunk and could take it out. Sometimes we have patients with giant liver tumors and we'd like to take them out, but they're encroaching on some major arteries and veins. We'll embolize them first, shrink the tumor down, and then we can go do the resection. And then the real controversy is, what do you do with the patient who has a low tumor burden, small tumors, but they're definitely growing? So you have, you know, should you treat patients for any progression, or should you wait if they have no symptoms until the tumor is kind of big enough that you feel like you need to pull the trigger? And you'll see that different institutions behave very differently. We're very conservative at Penn. I like to, you only have so many bullets in your gun. I like to wait as long as possible before I pull the trigger. But you go to Memorial Sloan Kettering, and they'll say, any progression, boom, you get your first embolization. So, and we don't know who's right and who's wrong. You're going to hear different philosophies at different places. So, how well does it work? Does it control symptoms? It's great for symptom control. 85% of the time you will control carcinoid symptoms by embolizing. Does it debulk disease or shrink you significantly? 55-60% of the time it'll do that. Not like surgery, but pretty good. How durable is it for grade 1 tumors? On average, it's about a year and a half before people get progression. It could be many years. About a third of our patients get out past 3 years with no progression after one cycle of embolization. How beneficial is it in the setting if you have disease outside your liver? Well, most progression occurs in the liver. So even when the disease is outside the liver, it's really important to treat the liver lesions. And what's the risk? Well, it's pretty low risk. The rate of severe toxicity mortality is extremely low. So here are your choices when you have to decide what kind of therapies to do. You can do embolization. You could do a target agent like everolimus. You could get chemotherapy like CAPTEM. You could get PRRT. And what you have to weigh is, what are your goals? Is your goal to debulk the tumor, so response rate is highest with embolization, lower for drugs? Or maybe it's not so important to debulk you. Maybe you just want long-term control, in which case you'll see duration of control may be better with systemic therapies than it is with localized therapies. And the toxicities all have their price. So, you know, people who get embolized have post-embolization syndrome, so it means they feel pretty crappy for a few weeks. People who get everolimus, about 70% have to reduce their dose because they can't tolerate it. High-grade severe adverse events with CAPTAM happen in about 40% of patients. PRT is generally pretty well tolerated. So you have to weigh all these factors in kind of deciding what's right for you. Then you have to question is, what therapy do you do? So we have many ways of embolizing patients. You can do what's called bland embolization. That goes back to the 1970s, where we just catheterize the artery, and we just inject little particles or gelatin or some kind of goo, and just cut off the blood flow to the arteries, to the tumors, and that's it. So you're just choking off the blood supply to kill them. And then in the 1980s, people said, well, why don't we mix some chemo drugs in there, and now we'll cut off the blood flow, and we'll deposit super concentrated chemotherapy, which will get stuck in the tumor for weeks, which is standardly how we treat, for example, primary liver cancer. And that can be done with what we call CTase, or conventional chemoembolization, where the drugs are in an oily emulsion, or DEBTase, drug-eluting BTase, where the drug is loaded on the little particles that we inject. And either way you do this, you're basically killing the tumor immediately by choking off its blood supply. People do get sicker from this. The liver can tolerate it, but most people get pain, fever, nausea if they stay in the hospital overnight. They generally feel pretty punky for a couple weeks, but the tumor's dead that day. So I call it quick and sick. The other alternative is radioembolization. You may have heard that it's called as TARE or CERT or Y90, because Y90 is the radioisotope. Here we're catheterizing the artery, but instead of plugging it up, like in bland or chemoembolization, we're instilling millions of little radioactive microspheres, kind of like men getting seeds in their prostates, except there's 10 million seeds. And the idea is they float out there and they embed themselves in the tumor and they radiate your tumor from the inside out. So the tumor dies slowly over weeks or months from internal radiation. Because we're not cutting off the blood flow to the liver, the side effects are very mild. 95% of patients do this as an outpatient. About half have zero side effects from doing this therapy. But radiation works very slowly. So it takes at least 3 months before you even know if it worked, before you can get a scan to see anything. So this is slow and glow. So when you're talking to your doctors, you can just think about it as quick and sick versus slow and glow as your alternatives. Now, what do people do? This is a practice survey from several years ago about how interventional oncologists treat various types of liver malignancies. And if you look at metastatic NETs, these are the frequencies of people doing bland embolization, the two kinds of chemoembolization and radioembolization. You can see it's about even. So across the country, these techniques are all used equally. And if you look at the current guidelines, NANETS, ENCCN guidelines, it basically says embolize by any means available to you. There's no recommendations among them. But that hopefully will change. So we have what's called RETNET. That's the randomized embolization trial for endocrine tumors. It's running in about a dozen centers in North and South America right now. And the idea was to randomize patients between bland embolization, conventional chemoization, or drug-eluting beads, because this, even though we've been doing it for decades, no one's ever done a study comparing them to each other. And the question is one more effective? Is one more toxic? And we're also doing quality of life surveys to just see what the patient experience it is from this already. And actually, we've learned a lot. So we had our first safety analysis after a certain number of patients have been accrued to each arm. And it turned out in the drug-eluting bead arm, 4 out of 10 patients had major complications. So that arm has actually already been closed because it turns out these beads were so toxic in patients with neuroendocrine tumors. So we've already learned something that's going to change practice guidelines from this study. So with that arm closed, now it's just a comparison between bland embolization and conventional chemoembolization, and we'll have to wait a few more years, unless something bad happens, to we accumulate more patients to see if one turns out to be better than the other. For radioembolization, there are some pros and cons to consider. So pros are it's safer than chemoembolization in patients with prior bile duct intervention. So if you had a Whipple or surgery on your bile duct, or you have a stent in your bile duct, then all the bacteria that live in your stomach now live in your liver as well. And if you get chemoembolization, your chance of getting a liver abscess is about 20%. And it's much lower if you get radioembolization. So we will prioritize your radioembolization in patients who've had a Whipple or biliary stent, because the risk of infection is way less. Also, it can be combined with CAP-TEM therapy, which is something we like to do a lot at Penn. CAP-TEM are both radiosensitizers, so they make radiation work better. And we have our preliminary study showing that it's safe to do them actually simultaneously instead of sequencing them. And we saw really impressive response rates and duration of response. That's still being investigated in terms of how good it really turns out to be, but it's a consideration. The thing against doing radioembolization, the cons, is that there are 3 centers that have reported that people who live long enough after radioembolization are at risk of developing late radiation-induced liver failure. And who lives long after this? NET patients. Most of other patients aren't quite so fortunate. So it turns out that between 2 and 10 years after radioembolization, you can develop radiation-induced cirrhosis and liver failure. And we see that between 10 and 20% of the time. So mostly because of this, this concern of late liver toxicity, we tend to hold off on radioembolization in our NET patients and do more bland embolization or chemoembolization first, unless they've had a Whipple or a bile duct stent. So, summary, when do we do this? Uncontrolled symptoms, a high tumor burden, or progression on octreotide. How do we do it? You can pick your poison, quick and sick versus slow and glow, but I recommend quick and sick. Unless you've had a prior biliary intervention, definitely do not do drug-eluting beads. So if you're going to a center, ask your interventional oncologist, what are they going to do? A lot of people still use DEBs, and you do not want them to do that to you. And then with what? Well, you can sequence it or you can combine it, CAP-TEM, PRT, biologics, or even surgery, and that's why you need a multidisciplinary tumor board. And that will wrap it up. Thank you.